Yes, winning the war in our mind, man. That's what we're trying to do and fight this good fight. Good morning, everybody. How are you? Good, 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 good. Welcome to Authentic Life Church. I'm Pastor Bruce. So thankful that you're here. We've started a new series called Winning the War in Your Mind, based on a book by Craig Groeschel. Hundreds and hundreds of people have bought in books, so I'm so thankful for that. Not essential to have it, but boy, oh boy, if you really want to get these and apply these, I think this is the way to do it. Pastor Danny already said, but you know, this Friday is our worship concert. So it's Friday at 7 o'clock. And it's a big deal because, you know, not only are we supposed to worship God because he's God, I mean, but he created worship because he knows that's what's best for us. If you've ever wondered, why does God really need our worship? No, he doesn't. We need to worship. We need to worship. And so if you take it to what we're studying today, you know, right? Garbage in, garbage out. Truth in, truth is going to come out. Positive in, positive out. Worship in, worship out. Your life will be better. You said it right. So we come in here on Friday night, and that's kind of, it's just really our songs, the worship songs that we do on Sunday. But we also temper it with, there's like the prayer areas, and people can get up. There's pillows over here and a cross. You can just have this moment with God. So there's some cool things that we're going to do. So be here on Friday. That would be awesome. Why don't you guys grab a Bible or a device and turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. So grab on your phone. I use YouVersion. Or if you brought a Bible in, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. So I wonder how many of you guys are in the middle of a pretty good life, but you seem to keep focusing on the negative. You know what I'm talking about? If you look at the scheme of things, your life is pretty decent, but yet you only pay attention to all the negative stuff. You seem to spiral out of control in that. I mean, especially when you compare it to other people around the world or people that you might know and you hear about, and you kind of go, yeah, honestly, I have a pretty good life, but I keep focusing on this negative. Well, today we're going to be talking about how do we get these negative thoughts out of our brain. Because remember, what we've been doing is we have these ruts that come in there, these negative lines. And it's actually easier to keep thinking negative thoughts than it is positive. It's easier because we've spent so much time in our life building these neural pathways or these like these negative ruts that go through there, that it's easier for your brain to go into that. And so we have to fight that. We have to transform. We have to do truth trenches, is what we looked at last week. Remember, our mind is a battlefield, and most of life's battles are won or lost in the mind. You know, if your mind is a battlefield, most of it, we just lose it when we go into wrong places, and we just get stuck there, and we got to get out. So here, I'm going to start right out with our very first point. Right here, if you're writing things down. The life we have is often a reflection of the thoughts that we think. The life we have, makes sense? The life we have is often a reflection of the thoughts that we think. If I keep thinking negative thoughts, if I keep looking at garbage, if I keep paying attention and wanting what other people have and feeling negative about myself, I'm going to go down that area and it's not going to be healthy. And so my life is going to be that. Here, let's look at it this way. It's almost impossible to have a positive life if all you're doing is thinking negative thoughts. I mean, that's not rocket science, is it? I mean, most of you are like, duh. You cannot have a positive life when you're having negative thoughts. On the other hand, it's so much easier to have a positive life if you have positive thoughts. So we need to get healthy in this area. Garbage in, garbage out. Truth in, truth out. Let's look at some truth. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. This is kind of a theme-ish verse for this series. Apostle Paul, who I told you is like our thought warrior, our truth warrior, and he says this in verse 3. For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. No, the weapons we fight with are not the weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. In other words, the weapons we do are with God, spiritual, and things like that. And then in verse 5, he says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Everybody say, take captive.
Take captive.
Yeah, we need to take captive our thoughts. Do you remember what a stronghold is? So I showed you a stronghold. These are a couple castles or forts, you know, would be a stronghold. Well, how that works in our mind is that it's like brick by brick, you've been building these walls around some negative thinking. Brick by brick, you've been setting, you know, these huge strongholds that literally when Jesus is trying to take captive your brain, when he's trying to come back in there and win this battle, these are areas that you go, nope, you can't touch. But they also become so ingrained in our own brain that it's almost hard to demolish them. Because since you were a kid, you've been believing the same thing. I'm fat and I'm ugly, or I'm not smart, or nobody's ever gonna like me, or I don't deserve to be happy. My mom always told me I'm a bad person, and so I just might as well live that out. This is a stronghold that you've been building brick by brick by brick. And it's so easy to go back and hide behind that garbage. And so what we need to do is tear down these things, and we need to take captive our thoughts. You know, a good example, we're on staff, and we're going through this book, and we just had book club on Tuesday, and one of our staff members, Savannah, you've seen her up here, she's always got a camera, and she does announcements and stuff, and I asked her if I could share this story, but we were all going around talking about our declarations, remember, what's our lies that we're believing, and what's the truth we need to do, and she spoke up, and you could tell it was pretty tough, and she goes, you know, I wake up with very negative mindset. I say a lot of negative things to me, and it's worse in the morning than it is the rest of the day. You know, what do you mean? She goes, oh, I just say, you know, I body image issues. I feel this. I don't like this about me. I just say these negative things over and over, you know, in my brain. So she said, what I decided is I wrote my declaration on my mirror so I'd see it every morning. And so she wrote it on her mirror, and it was this beautiful declaration, you know, just about your fearfully and wonderfully made and all these different things. And then she said she put a picture of herself when she was 5 years old on the mirror. Why'd she do that? She said, because I would never say those mean, ugly, horrible things to that little 5-year-old girl. So why do I think it's okay to say those same things to me now? I thought that was brilliant. You know, when she said that, I gasped. I just went, like, who would talk to a little 5-year-old and say trashy things like that? So why do you think it's okay to say? And you know what? That's the battle that a lot of you have. A lot of us have. You know, I had somebody else tell me. They talk to their son, and all they do is build up their son, their little 2-year-old. And they're like, you're wonderful. You're awesome. And then he thought to himself, but why don't I talk to myself that way? Why do I only say negative things to myself? Well, that's what we're going to work on today. Let's get rid of the negative thoughts. Amen? Let's fight this. Hey, one sermon's not going to change your life, but it could set you on a course that changes your life. True? True. So let's take this seriously. Let's pray. Father, thank you for drawing all of us here. We welcome you in such a great way, but we realize something. We often battle these negative things, and we fill our lives and our hearts with lies. And some of those have been given to us by other people that were wicked, that were hurtful, harmful, but lots of it's also just been us. And so, God, we just want to be transformed today. Change us as you challenge us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so we're going to talk about what's called cognitive biases. The reason why a lot of times we think negative and go through life negative is we have these cognitive biases or sometimes thought or filters, maybe mental filters might be a good way. So what's a cognitive bias? So if you're writing things down, here you go. Cognitive bias is this: a mistake in reasoning based on personal experiences and preferences. It's a mistake in reasoning based on things. You have a bias. But now all of us have biases, right? Like maybe some of you are biased towards Republican Party, others are Democrat or whatever. That's a bias. But a mistake in reasoning, the cognitive bias, is because certain entrenchments that are in your life cause you to see the world in a certain way. Just like we'd say, some people see the glass half full, some see it half empty. Some of that is a cognitive bias. You're maybe not reasoning properly. I can put it like this. You're a young woman, and you've been abused by men. And you get to the point to where you actually get to the point to where you believe all men are abusive. Okay, is that a true statement? No, not all men are abusive. But because of the abuse in your past, that's your bias as you go through. Or let's say you're a kid growing up and your parents always told you that people that are wealthy are bad and that they're always trying to control everybody and they do these things. And so you just kind of grew up with a bias that people that are wealthy are bad. But then as you grew up, you started rising up in your company. And next thing you know, you're doing pretty well. And you start feeling guilty all the time, especially around your parents. That's a cognitive bias. Your reasoning is based on certain things from your past. You know, Pastor Brian shared with me the other day. He goes, yeah. He goes, I grew up, my mom told me salt would kill you because she had an uncle that died of a heart attack and blamed salt. And she's always like, salt will kill you, salt will kill you. And so at 4 years old, he was literally in a restaurant and he stood up on the booth and he lifted up a salt shaker at 4 years old and shouted out to the restaurant, this stuff will kill you, salt will kill you. And now he's grown up and he says he's a saltaholic. And so he's got all this guilt going on. And so he's in therapy for it. But isn't that funny? That would be a cognitive bias. And so we have these. It's kind of like an air filter in your car. It's to keep the cruddy stuff out so it cleans your car. But if you never change it, you just keep filling it with all this junk, then eventually all that junk will still start coming in. And we need to change the filter. We need to change some of these cognitive biases that aren't true. And we need to get rid of the ruts that are in our life that are negative and create truth trenches that are going to now make it easier to think positive or God-given things. So it's not just the filter that often that matters. It's also how we frame it, okay? So it's also how we frame things, how we look at that. And so psychologists and the book talks about it. The whole third unit is all about reframing things. And so that's what we're really going to be looking at mostly today is how do we reframe things. So let me tell you what reframing is all about. Reframing is this: creating a different way of looking at a situation or relationship by changing its meaning. Okay, looking at a situation and reframing it and seeing which we're going to get into. Where is God in this? Where is hope in this? What's going to happen? So let me show you something. We're going to show a photo back here. So this is what I want everybody to do. Can you take your fingers like as if you're making pretend little pistols? Everybody do this. Okay, if you're not doing it, God's watching. Okay, I might not be able to see you very well. Okay, you're going to do that. Now, point them both in one direction, either a person or whatever you want to do. Okay, now, take the one that's next to your chest and keep it just like it is. Take the other one and flip it and make a rectangle, a frame. Okay, no, you're just going like that. Thumb to finger. Okay, now this is what, you ever see this in movie? Like movie directors in the past are like, like they're looking at the frame. Now I want you to take your frame, and I want you to focus it over here in this dark area, okay? So now you're kind of looking at that dark area. Now kind of picture that equals negative thinking. That's bad self-talk. That's negative stuff. Now take your same frame and now let's lift it up here to this up section up here in the bright part over there. That's positive. That's reframing. So now let's use it like this. So you wake up in the day and you go, my day is going to suck. It's just not going to be any good. And you're framing over here and you go, I hate my work and I'm going to go to there and all these people are just jerks and I don't like any of them and my boss is rude and he's always criticizing me and this and that and my husband is just a jerk and my only favorite part of my day is when I go to work and I talk bad about my husband to all the other coworkers and my kids. Oh, don't get me started on my kids. Oh my gosh, it's all this. And this is how you wake up in the morning. Well, guess what the rest of your day is going to be like? You cannot have a positive outcome if everything you're thinking is negative. It just doesn't work. But now take that same person and they wake up and they go, yeah. Work is tough and I got some people that aren't really my favorite, but I'm going to be a blessing. I'm going to go to my office and they're going to see God in me. And you know what? My husband might not be perfect, but man, I'm thankful that I'm married to the man and he does great things. And my kids, yeah, they can be pistols sometimes. But you know what? Last Friday was so fun when we all went to the movies together. And you reframe that and you wake up in the morning and you're like, you know what? I'm blessed. You know, reframing what's going on. It's not a name it and claim it type thing. It's just looking. Same picture. Same day. The facts have not changed. It's the way we frame it that makes the difference. The facts are not any different. Same job, same whatever, but reframing it makes all the difference. You know, Oh, I hate everything that's going on in government and all this stuff, and our world's going to hell in a handbasket, which might be. But I go over here and I say, but you know what? I am in this world to make a difference. Jesus Christ has challenged me to love people and no matter what's going on, and I'm going to pray for my country. I'm going to pray for these different things. You see, the facts have not changed. The world is going to hell in a handbasket. But the way I frame it is very, very different. Make sense? So listen, you cannot control what happens to you, but you can control how you frame it. You can't always control what happens to you. There's accidents happen, things happen. I mean, I look around and I just think all of us, we have bad things happen. The world is a storm. There are problems, always have been, always will be. The Huns always come over the hill and attack and rape and pillage the village. These things have never changed. You know, they're just different names to them. You know, there's car accidents, loss of family members, abusive people, hurt feelings, friends let you down. And that's just my life. What's going on in yours? What has gone on in yours? See, the facts don't change, and we can't really control what happens to us all the time, but we can control how we frame it. And so we're going to look at that a little bit more as we go on. You know, if we look at the Apostle Paul, let's use the Apostle Paul. So if you're sitting here in this seat and you're going, man, I'm always feel like I get let down. I have all these negative things happen to me. Well, you know what? The Apostle Paul gets you. Okay, remember, we're really focusing on him. He's our mental monster, you know, our truth trencher, and he's going to help us along. So here's the thing. The Apostle Paul was picked by God, Jesus specifically, to bring his church to the un-Jewish nations. And boy, Apostle Paul did it. He'd raise up people, and yet sometimes he'd get arrested. The Jews would walk him in the streets, and they would stone him, and they'd beat him with rods. He's been in shipwrecks. He's had all these different things. But none of that stopped him. He kept bringing the gospel to different places. And you read about a lot of this in the book of Acts, and you get to see it in the different churches, you know, right? Corinthians is to the church in Corinth, which is in Greece. And Philippians is in the church in Philippi, which is also in Greece, and these different places like that. Well, he knew that God told him that he was going to go to Rome and that he was going to be able to go to Rome and start raising churches. And the reason why this was a big deal is because all roads led to Rome and all roads led out of Rome. The Roman Empire was amazing at building roads, and they built roads. And he knew if we could just get the gospel to Rome, the gospel would ring out to all the rest of the world. Once it hits Rome, boom! The world is going to become a Christian culture, right? And so he can't wait to preach in Rome. But guess what happens? He doesn't go to Rome underneath his own power. He gets arrested, and he ends up finding himself in prison in Rome. And he's under house arrest, and he's got a jailer that's always attached to him, chained to him, 24 hours a day. And so instead of preaching in Rome, he's a prisoner in Rome. And so how Paul could have framed it is he could have sat down and he could look at it like this and he'd go, oh man, I got so let down. I thought I was going to be preaching in Rome and now I'm a prisoner in Rome. And I can't believe how God has let me down. He promised me I didn't expect for this. You know what? I'm done with this church thing. I'm done with this Christian thing. Why am I a missionary when people keep arresting me and bad things keep happening? Blah, 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 blah. But this is what he says. Look at Philippians chapter 1 in verse 12 and 13. Now see how he reframes it. Now, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. What is he saying? He goes, I'm reframing it like this. He goes, listen, in case you're worried about me, don't. Guess what's happening? Yeah, I've got a palace guard member that's attached and chained to my arm every day. So guess who's the real captive? He's a captive audience. I'm sharing the gospel. I'm reaching them. And all these people in the palace guard, they're all coming to Jesus. And they're telling other people. And it's happening. And I'm just sitting here and stuck in this place. And the gospel's going out. Same picture reframed, right? Or look at verse 14. He goes, and because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all of the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. In other words, guess what? Because I'm in chains, other people from other churches, they're going even being more bold and they're sharing their faith. And more people are coming to Jesus. Because I'm in this prison in Rome, the gospel is going out. And that's exactly what happened. Same picture. Different framing. That's what we need to do. That's how it needs to get in order for us to be healthy. Point number two is this. Reframing your story and relationships may change your life. If you haven't got it, the reason why we come to church and one of the things that we want to learn and grow in is to not be stuck in our ruts. That when we give our lives to Jesus, He transforms, He does something. And we need to renew our minds. And so reframing things can really actually change your life. So I'm going to give you three different specific things, okay? The first one is this. Thank God for what didn't happen. I just think something that could happen, like a lot of us can have negative things, we can have bad things, but we focus so much on that negative, and we forget to thank God for what didn't happen. Now, I want to preface this like this. There are some really bad things that happen. I mean, I have a really hard time. Someone being raped, how do you find something good or thank God what didn't happen? I guess you didn't die, I guess, but no. I mean, it's just tough. And there's some wicked things that happen. Deaths and you know, your child died of an overdose. You know, I mean, what, thank God for what didn't happen? No, man, there's just some things. Remember, God didn't tell us to give thanks for every situation. He just said give thanks in it or through it to find what to do. And so there's a time where we need to, but most scenarios, okay, there's the radical ones, but most scenarios, we need to do a better job of thanking God what didn't happen. Let me tell you like this, like unanswered prayer. Now, when I say unanswered prayer, God always answers it, just sometimes it's no. But unanswered prayer, I thank God a lot of times for the times He didn't answer the prayer the way I wanted it. See, if it was the way I wanted it, then I would have been married to a girl named Thelma, which was my first kiss when I was 5 years old. You know, and I'm thankful I'm not married to Thelma. I'm married to Melissa. You know, and so there's unanswered prayers. I'm thankful for jobs I didn't get because something else happened. I'm thankful for certain events that happened in my life, even at the time that were negative, but I'm thankful that he didn't answer that prayer and stuff that I wanted so bad because, man, I can look back at the outcome would be better. You know, or I remember I watched the news yesterday a little bit on and the hurricane that was going on, and they were interviewing different people, and this car comes by, and they had the microphone in there, and the couple just said, yeah, our electricity finally came on, but we still don't have any water. And then the wife yells out, she goes, but man, we're just thankful to be alive. You know, what is she doing? She's reframing the situation, a disaster, and she reframes it. And she goes, God is so good, as they drove off. You know, or, you know, my parents moved to Texas when I was in college. I don't know if they're just trying to get away from me or whatever, but they moved to Texas for about 5 years. They came back. But while they're there, my brother, who we have a 13 years age difference, he was 8 years old and I'm in college. And I get a phone call and I guess he fell out of a tree and he broke the growth plate right here in his arm, shattered it, you know, right here in his elbow. So he fell out of the tree, landed on his arm, shattered his growth plate. And my parents just say, can you pray for him? But my parents weren't believers, but will you pray for him? Because if the growth plate doesn't get put back together properly, his arm might be shrunken. And I go, okay, so I didn't know that. I don't know if you knew that. But we prayed, a bunch of people gathered around and pray, and then they called me up and said, everything looks like it's going to be all good, but we won't know for a couple years. And so I just need to tell you, my brother's arms are normal. They're tiny, but that's only because he doesn't work out. But he got normal. So we thank God for what didn't happen. He could have died. You know, he could have fell and hit his head and had more mental damage than he already naturally has. And he's not here, is he? Is Jason here? Okay, I don't know. But here's the thing is that we got to thank God for what didn't happen. Obviously, there are some horrible things that it's hard to find any good in it. But a lot of times, people, we just need to thank God for what didn't happen. Let's go on to the second one I want to tell you. It's called pre-framing, not just reframing, but pre-framing events. What that is pre-framing, deciding beforehand how you're going to frame things. I do this all the time. You hear me talk about it, how every time I go into my life group, I always pray. And I always go, Lord, help me to be a blessing. Help me to be a good example. Help me not to talk so much, you know, whatever. That doesn't usually work, but that's I try to pre-frame it. So I almost wonder, what would it be like if I didn't pre-frame it, you know? And that's kind of sometimes it's pre-prayer framing, you know, doing it through prayer. Or all the time, I go home, and when my kids were young, Lord, I'm tired, but I just want to be a gift to my kids when I get in that door. Help me to smile, you know? I'm pre-framing that event. Well, a lot of us need to be able to do that. So let's go back to our picture. You remember we have, we talked about last week, self-fulfilling prophecies, where that person comes in and they frame, they're going to go to the party. Everybody talks to me to go to the party. They go, why should I go to the party? No one will talk to me. Everybody be rude to me. I'm not liked or whatever. And what do? They go to the party and they stand up next to the corner like this. What do? They pre-frame, they self-fulfill the prophecy. They said, no one's going to talk to me. Of course no one's talking to you. You look like you're mad. Right? Pre-framing. But you can, you know, you want to do it in a positive way. One of my best friends ever, her name is Keller. We actually named our daughter Corinne Keller Fosdick after Keller. And me and a bunch of friends in college, we all went to Mexico together. The girls had their rooms, the guys had our rooms, all platonic. And there was like three girls and two guys. And we went to Mexico. And one night we were going dancing. And everybody got dressed up. And now, Keller always had self-image issues. She was a little chubby, I guess, but beautiful face, beautiful everything. But, and man, her insecurities just wrecked her. And we go to this dance club, and I guess the girls wanted to dance with more than just me and my buddy Greg. And so they wanted other people to ask them. And sure enough, Julia, somebody, she's dancing with some guy and whatever. And then there's another girl, Sharon, she gets somebody dancing with her. And then, but nobody ever danced with Keller other than me. And we leave the dance club. And I remember me and Keller are out on the beach. We went out there and she just started crying. And she put her head on my shoulder and she was just crying. And I said, what? And she goes, nobody danced with me. It's because of this, because of that. And I go, no, Keller, it's not. You're gorgeous. It's not anything like that. I said, this is what I saw. Every time a man walked by, you would put your head down like this. I said, we're still scared little boys that are looking for somebody that wants us to dance with them. And so if I walk by and you put your head down, that lets me know that you think I'm ugly. And you think, you don't want to dance with me. I said, so every time you had somebody walk by, you put your head down, and all you were telling them is, don't touch me, don't be around me. And I didn't know the term pre-framing, but basically I said, next time we go out to a dance club, frame it the other way. And sure enough, a couple nights later, we went out to a dance club, and Keller looked up every time a guy walked by, and still nobody danced with her. No, just kidding. No, all these people danced with her. She was like the life of the party. She's out there. And I'm like, yeah! What's the difference? She normally framed, the one night she framed it like this, and the other one was, I'm going to go in confidence. We need to walk into places. Look at me, I'm a church planter. That's kind of a difficult thing to do. You know, there's nothing there, and it doesn't exist, and then it's going to exist. But it's not really about me. It's about the philosophy that I have, and I look around and see what God is doing, and then I want to join Him. What I have lived my life, this is my philosophy. You ask any of the staff members, look around and see what God is doing and then join Him. And then it just happens. So ALC happens because God was planning something and we just needed to see it and we joined Him in what He wanted to do. And that's the way it works. Or even coming up here to preach. I know for a fact the Holy Spirit wants to bless you. I know for a fact He wants the Word to be preached to you. I know for a fact that our living God wants to change your life. So when I come up from backstage, I have confidence because I pre-framed it, not naming and claiming it. It's just real. I go, God's in it. If God's in it, then I'm not going to get in the way. You know, right? I'm just going to boldly go out there. And so that's what we need to do. Go with confidence. You know, that what does God want to do and join Him? So it's not, again, it's not name it and claim it and therefore it happened just because you dreamed it, but it is jumping in and seeing things. It's pre-framing it from negative, self-fulfilling prophecy to no, God is good. And that brings us to the third one, is this. Look for the goodness of God. Look for God's goodness in things in this world. You always find what you're looking for. Let me say that. You're always going to find what you're looking for. You want to see the negative? Then that's what you're going to see. You want to see the goodness of God? Then you're going to see the goodness of God. It's just the way it is. Look for the goodness of God. It is everywhere. It is. He is. And you just need to find that. Again, if we look at an area, the hummingbird and the vulture, okay? You see the vulture? What do vultures do? They look around for dead things. They just search. That's their whole existence, is just to see something, and they just want dead, lifeless things. But what does the hummingbird do? The hummingbird's always looking around for sweet things. Which one do you want to be? The vulture or the hummingbird? Because you're going to find what you're looking for all the time. It's called cognitive reframing. It's taking things and looking at it, and so search for the goodness of God. You know, what we really should do is we need to have Jesus be able to frame things for us. And I want to give a couple of examples of looking for the goodness of God where I see Jesus in it. So in my life, I lived in the dorms, and at the time I was at the university, it was a smaller university, 4,000 students, and almost everybody lived in the dorms. There wasn't any apartments around or anything. And so, but by my third year, I wanted to be a resident assistant of the dorms. In fact, my two other friends, Dan and Sharon, and me, applied. And I was the shoo-in. Everybody knew. They're like, Bruce, you're going to get it. You know, you're this, and you always counsel people, blah, blah, blah. And I knew I was going to get it. But I didn't get it. My two friends did. I did not. And it was one of the most devastating weeks of my life because I also found out that one of the reasons why I didn't get it is because of my Christian faith. And I was a really strong Christian, and a couple of the people were very against that. But I was devastated. And it was one of the few times in my life that I feel like I was wrecked, like that I went to God and you're not good. I've only done it like once or twice where I'm like, how could you let this happen? This is so unfair. And I think I was crying. I was walking in the quad. And I was like, I can't believe it. And now I'm embarrassed and blah, 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 blah. This isn't fair. And how could you let this happen? Well, see, at my university, you can only be a resident assistant, an RA, for 2 years. After that, you had to actually leave the campus. Well, I was a master's student, so I had 6 years of college and would have nowhere else to live. But what happened is I didn't get it that year, but I did get it the following year. And it was the second year, which I would have been gone, that I met Melissa. This beautiful, awesome woman came into the dorms, and we met and fell in love. And she's the greatest ministry partner I could ever imagine, you know? And so I look at it. That what was devastating, and you have stories like this, what was devastating at the time, I now look back and I go, thank God. Thank God. And I see the goodness of God in it. He's like, Bruce, I know this hurts, but wait till you see the gift I'm going to bring to you. You know, I know this hurts now, but trust me. You know, seeing the goodness of God. Speaking of wonderful people. She's been working in the children's area. She does a character called the professor, and she goes over there in the children's area. So thank you for serving. Yeah, so her hair doesn't look that good, so don't look at her hair. Great ministry partner, bad hair. Who am I to say? Who am I to talk? You know, or another one. Melissa and I planted a church in 1991. And it was right out of seminary. And we're planting our first church. We're excited. I'm a church planter. This is going to go great. Jesus and me are in it. It's going to go fantastic. It lasted 4 months. Devastated. Stepped out of ministry. I was so hurt and all this stuff. And I was devastated. And then all of a sudden, a church out in Los Angeles called Reseda Baptist called me up and said, hey, would you think about starting a college ministry for us? And that's what I did before. And so we interviewed and we got there and we started this college ministry, which we would call YA here, young adults. And there was only, you've heard this story before, but there was only one college student, only one person that age. No one between the ages of 18 and 40 at this church. It was a sea of gray and one student, and his name was Danny Urbaugh. And 20-year-old Danny Urbaugh, yeah, and he our worship pastor, but he was there. And we started this college ministry, and we ended up growing it to be the largest college ministry in the San Fernando Valley, which was 2.5 million people. And we did that and raised him up to be a leader. Then I came out here, and he took over and all kinds of stuff. We've been in ministry together for 30 years. And as hard as it was to plant a church and it failed, and I'm not saying there's good things in that, but I can see the goodness in God that if that didn't happen, I never would have met Danny. And apart from my wife, the greatest partner in ministry I could ever imagine. So here what I'm doing, what am I doing? I'm reframing that which was bad into that which is good. Or you guys know the story that, you know, Pastor Danny and I and we were looking at things we shouldn't look, and we confessed that to our elders at a church, and things went awry, and somebody wanted my job and blah blah blah, and the next thing you know, they're asking us to leave. It's indecent, you know, they were like, we think the world of you, we think great things are going to happen, but I think it's time after 18 years of you being our pastor. Ah, man, I'm walking around forever going, what am I going to do? Life is horrible. This is the worst thing. It's hurt people. It's hurt me. It's hurt my family, whatever. And then what does God do? He says, I am in the business of making beauty out of ashes. And I am not done with you, Bruce Fosdick. I'm not done with you, Danny Urba. And you know what? Next thing you know, Authentic Life Church exists. And it explodes, and it's been reaching people for Jesus, and lives have been changing. And I just love that God does that. And see, this is what we must always remember. Jesus wants to be a part of your story. Jesus needs to be in your story. Look at this, Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. He didn't say all things are good. Being fired from your job isn't good, but he works it for the good. That's our God. And so what we need to do is we need to stop interpreting the goodness of God through our circumstances, because our circumstances might not be good, but that doesn't mean God isn't good. We need to look at our circumstances through the goodness of God. You see the difference? Stop interpreting the goodness of God through our circumstances. Instead, we're to interpret our circumstances through the goodness of God. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus coming into our life, changing our life, making a difference in our life, knowing that he's a God that likes to take ashes and make beauty out of him. He makes wonderful things out of this life that you have. And I'm not saying your life has been perfect, and some of you have had even more devastating things than I could even imagine. But Jesus now has picked you up, and he says, I saved you for a reason, and eternity is yours. And I walk through life, no matter what happens to me, I know eternity is mine, and I'll never lose that. And it makes all the difference. Why? Because Jesus makes all the difference. He's made room for me. It's all about rewriting stories. You know, I hear people say this all the time. They go, Pastor, how come I come to Jesus and 1 month later my mom died? Or somebody goes, I finally signed up for a life group, and the next thing I know, I lost my job. That's horrible. You know, what happened? And I say, well, why are you framing it that way? Why don't you look at it like this? God already knew that your mom was going to die, and he brought you to himself, and he brought you to this church so that you could be ministered and loved, and he could carry you and walk you through this tragedy. How do you know that you didn't come to this life group and God always knew that you were going to lose that job, but he brought you to this awesome life group so they could pray for you and they could help you and they can get your mind straight? See how it is? We need to look like that and see what God is doing and how he brought you to a place to bring healing, because Jesus is the answer, always has been, always will be. Amen? You know, we're going to get ready for communion. Hopefully you grabbed communion cups when you came in. If you didn't, you can get up now and go get one outside that door. But grab that. And I'm going to close this in prayer, but I'm also going to have us be able to go into communion. Remember, communion is all about laying our sins before Jesus and realizing that he died on the cross for us, and he forgives us our sins, and we just need to receive that. But speaking of that, if you haven't received Jesus, I want to give you an opportunity to do that today too. So let's just pray. Oh God, we thank you so much, Jesus, that we love you. We are thankful for what you've done. We know that we sometimes can have the same situation and the guy next to us will look at it totally different. But we want to look at it through truth. We want you to get rid of these ruts of doubt, and these ruts of negativity out of our heads, and replace them with the truth. Because it's the truth that sets us free, and we know truth is a person, Jesus Christ. So thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If you have not received Jesus and you want to do that today, right now, what a great day to do it and say, today's my day. I'm going to give my life over to Jesus right now. Could you lift your hand up real high so I can see it? Say, I'm going to give my life to Jesus right now. There's someone over there. Anybody else? Don't be afraid. Just lift it up. Okay, I'm going to pray this prayer, and just pray this after me. I see a couple. Yeah, there you go. Thank you. Go ahead and put your hands down. Let's pray this prayer after me in your heart. Jesus, come into my life. I ask you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you for dying on the cross for me. I now want to live for you. I give you my life because you first gave me yours. I receive you now in Jesus' name. And Lord, as we take communion, we just want to take this time to reflect on the goodness that is you. Thank you for your forgiveness. I want you to just take a moment, everybody, and just kind of talk to God in your own words, and then we're going to take communion together in a second. But remember, Jesus gave his body and his blood for us. But just take this time to say, sorry for my sins, and lay them at the cross right now. Why don't you take your communion cup and open up the bread side? Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross. Let's take this together. Let's flip over the cup. Say, I receive this. Thank you for everything you've given me, Lord. I wish you didn't have to die for me, but I'm so thankful that you did. Let's take the cup together.